Recently, I ran into a soldering problem after receiving three new printed circuit board designs I made. You see, the first one's challenge is that it is an aluminium PCB, and the second and third one's challenge is that they need plastic connectors soldered to them, which come with tons of very close to one another pins. And my soldering problem for these PCBs is that I'm simply not satisfied with the soldering techniques I'm familiar with so far. Hand soldering does not work for the LEDs, since they cover the spot where I have to solder them, and due to accuracy reasons, it is also very hard to hand solder the connectors in place. Spreading solder paste and using hot air to reflow solder the connectors is possible, but with this technique I often like to burn things, and sometimes even fry components. And additionally, it does not really work for the LEDs, since the aluminium gobbles up all the heat. And last but not least, I got the reflow oven, which does work in both cases, but you can hardly see what is going on the PCB, and this solution is also bulky. And that is why I was looking for another better technique, and quickly found out about hot plate reflow soldering, which, like the name implies, is basically a hot plate that heats up, and thus evenly heats up the PCB on top of it as well. So I bought myself such a hot plate, and while testing it out, a viewer of mine reached out to me with a DIY solution, which I of course also had to try out. That means in this episode of DIY or Buy, we will not only find out whether hot plate soldering is the best soldering technique for me, but also whether you should make your own hot plates or simply buy one. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, who offer the most affordable PCB, SMT assembly service and also 3D printing service. Every PCB I ordered so far arrived at my place within a week, and needless to say, the quality is excellent. So why not start your PCB and SMT adventure today, at a price point of only $2? And if that is too much for you, then let me tell you that the top 8 comments underneath this video with the most likes will get a $50 JLC PCB discount code. Let's start off with the commercial solution, and I think I got the most popular one with the MHP30 hot plates that you can get for around $100. For that price, you get an excellent and robust build quality combined with the USB Type-C PD inputs and an intuitive to use user interface that you control with two push buttons. That all sounds nice, but can this hot plate do its main job properly? To find that out, I prepared a small PCB with solder paste and placed the components on it. Now the solder paste I'm using is the SN42BY58 type, which according to the internet comes with a low melting point, but according to some reflow curves I found, the peak temperature should be around 160 degrees Celsius. And by the way, the bi-hot plate apparently does not follow such a reflow curve, and only heats up and stays there, but the DIY solution later does feature a temperature curve. But honestly speaking, I only care about a good soldering end result. And with that being said, I set the temperature of the commercial plate to 160°C and firstly gave it a test run. As you can see, the plate heats up without a problem and the display temperature is also close to what the real temperature is. That means it was time for a proper test, and I have to say that also worked out flawlessly, and I was very happy with the end results. So all in all, the buy option is a functional high quality hot plate, which basically only comes with one major flaw, and that is its small size, which makes it hard to use for medium sized boards. Now of course, there are big and bulky hot plates you can buy as well, but it feels like there is nothing in between. But here comes the DIY option into play, which was presented to me by a viewer named Chris with pictures like these, and I was immediately interested. You see, the concept of his design is that when you have a long enough copper conductor, it comes with a non-neglectable resistance, and when current flows through that, it creates heat. Instead of using copper wire though, Chris designed a long copper trace on a PCB, which in this case comes with a resistance of 1.2 ohm. And once again, by letting current flow through it, it can reach very high temperatures for reflow soldering. But we also need control electronics in order to not let the temperature rise indefinitely. Chris of course came up with its own system, which I want to explain briefly. The heart of it is like usual a microcontroller, in this case the Atmega 328P, which is the heart of many Arduinos. The microcontroller of course needs a couple of important inputs and outputs for such a hot plate job, like a temperature sensor, in order to know how hot the plate is. In this case we're using the LMT85, that outputs a voltage almost linear to the measured temperature. Then we need two push buttons as inputs in order to control the user interface shown on an OLED that acts as an output. And last but not least, most importantly, we need a MOSFET output that we can turn on and off quickly in order to adjust the heating power of the hot plates. Of course, we also need some complementary power regulators and protection components. But overall, this is all such a hot plate control circuit requires. And all that is now missing is a bit of code that lets all the components interact with one another in order to ultimately let the hot plate follow the reflow soldering curve while implementing some safety features. Now I will not go into detail about the code Chris wrote, but let me tell you that it is written in a way that you can easily understand everything. If you're interested in getting it or building this project, then you can have a look at its GitHub page. But anyway, with the theory out of the way, I downloaded the Gerber files and component list from GitHub to not only order the PCBs from JLC PCB, but also get all the components. After a week, all the stuff arrived at my place, and at this point it would have been time for the assembly, but sadly one important component was still missing. The problem is that ordering the microcontroller at Mega 328P is pretty much impossible or way too expensive nowadays. But what is not impossible is buying cheap Arduinos. So I had to steal the microcontroller from one, and then it was time to spread the solder paste onto the PCB and position all the components on there. The way I like to do it is to go through each component bag individually and then crossing off the components I just placed on the schematic. This way I know for sure what components are already on the boards and what is still missing. But anyway, after all SMD components were in place, I used my hot air station to solder them and then cleaned the PCB with isopropanol before having a look at it under the microscope. The results didn't look half bad, but I touched up the microcontroller once more just to be on the safe side. Afterwards, I soldered all the THT components in place and did a first test run with 12 volt power, which didn't let it explode. Brilliant! So next, I programmed an Arduino Uno to be an ISP programmer, which I then connected to the hotplate microcontroller through the ICSP interface. And if all of that sounds super complicated to you, then simply have a look at the how to program guide from Chris, where it is all explained with more details. So after choosing the correct programming settings, I wanted to set the correct fuses of the hot plate's microcontroller by burning the bootloader, which sadly didn't work at all. Guess what, since the microcontroller was used with an Arduino that uses an external crystal for the 16 MHz clock signal, it will not function in any way without receiving such a signal. But since I knew where to inject the clock signal and also had a function generator laying around, it was no problem to do just that. And thus, it was finally possible to not only upload the bootloader, but also the main code of the DIY hotplate. And after then adding the OLED screen and powering everything up, it seems like it all functions properly. And I like that the user interface is very simplistic by only letting you choose a temperature. So next, I added metal standoffs and went for first heat up tests, which drew quite a bit of power and heated the surface up without a problem, but featured a slight 15°C difference to the real temperature of the hot plates. But you know, that shouldn't be such a big deal for my reflow soldering tasks, which I tried out next, and I have to say that pretty much all of them turned out great. Of course, when it comes to my aluminium PCB, then there are still space problems, but it did work out in the end somehow as well. So all in all, I can now say that hot plate reflow soldering is my new favorite soldering technique, because it is so easy to do. And I'm also very happy with the DIY version as well as with the buy version, which both come with their own advantages and slight disadvantages. The big one of the PCB version is that it is not clear how often the PCB can handle the setup cooldown process, meaning it will probably not survive as long as the buy version. But then again, DIY is a lot cheaper if we only calculate with the price to build one PCB, which you will hopefully be able to enjoy when Chris turns this all into a proper product. And with that being said, I think both DIY and buy are this time the winner for me. And I hope you enjoyed this project and learned something along the way. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!